afternoon, everyone, and welcome to, I think, what you'll find to be a really exciting and informative panel. I'm going to start off with a little story to sort of help illustrate why this is so important to our community, this topic of diversity. In 1998, myself and three of my classmates, we recently finished our astronaut candidate training, and we were assigned to go to Russia to work on the operations startup for the space station with our Russian counterparts. And that was sort of a nebulous thing, just go over there, help us get started with operations. And so we went over there and started working with the Russians. And it was a really interesting experience because we would talk to them about, hey, you know, we need to do this. And they'd say, no, we need to do that. And it was interesting because we ran into, they had 40 years of experience in space and they did things this way. You know, of course, and we had 40 years of experience in space and we did things this way. And we had to negotiate through that. And it was really eye-opening. And over the years, I've watched that unfold. You know, I worked eventually with the Japanese and the Europeans and the Canadians as well. And what's really was fascinating was watching how all these different cultures and these different systems approach problem solving. And 20 years later, if you look at where the station program is and the things that we've learned from each other, we've managed to extract the really good things that the Russians did, the really good things, that approaches the Japanese have, with the really good approaches that we established in the U.S. and the really good approaches that the Canadians and, of course, Europe brought to the table. And the space station is an incredibly rich and strong program because of how all that diversity and viewpoints came together to create this amazing, international, very successful project. Now, it was painful, and it took a while, but we got there in the end. And so observing that process for the last 20 years, one thing that was really obvious to me, too, is our culture here in the U.S. is the most adaptable to this kind of a concept, because our country is made of a broad, diverse group of people with a broad, diverse group of experiences, and that's just our kind of norm. And so we naturally fall into this kind of thinking, even though we still have a ways to go. We are probably more than any culture in the country, and I admit I'm in the world, and I'm a little bit of a bias, prepared to handle this task and handle it well. And that's, I think, a key to why this community, the new space, this commercial startup space, has been so successful, because we can be really innovative, because we bring all those diverse viewpoints to the problem solving, and we do that better than anybody else in the world. And so in order for us to be continuing the success that we've started on and continuing our momentum, we need to be a little bit more mindful about how we're using diversity, if we're using it the way that we need to, if we're creating environments where a lot of different people with a lot of different experiences and backgrounds can come together and create this sort of very difficult but very good space to come up with wonderful solutions to problems. And so what you're going to hear from today are some experiences from our industry in the area of diversity, concerns that we have, things that we're doing well, things that we can do better, and hopefully we can learn as a group to sort of build on our natural kind of cultural skill set that we have. So I'm going to, with that introduction, hand it over to Jill to pick up and lead us along this path that we'll explore this afternoon. Jill,
okay.
It's all yours.
Okay. I've got a few slides, so I'll stand up here. Do I just click the right one, or is there a clicker? I guess they'll do it for me. That's fine. So I'm, as I said, I'm Jill Reckie. I'm with NCWIT. It is the National Center for Women in IT. And our mission is to significantly increase women's meaningful participation in technology innovation. So that's our mission. We do three things. We equip, we are a research brand, and so our primarily what we do is create research and distribute it. Evidence-based approaches that you can use in your organization. We're constantly learning. We convene a learning community of over 850 organizations nationwide. It's companies and universities and K-12 organizations who have all tried things, some unsuccessfully, and so we can tell you what doesn't work. And we can also tell you what has worked and been successful, because we measure and evaluate everything we do. We're primarily funded by the National Science Foundation, and so a lot of evaluation and evidence has to be part of the equation. I'm excited to announce, I guess, that Virgin Galactic has joined as the first space company to join NCWIT.
Excellent.
And that was one of the goals that I had a year ago when Pat invited me to come. It's thanks to the connections made at ISPCS last year and also to Jonathan's commitment to making Virgin Galactic an inclusive culture. So we also unite two notable programs that help organizations collaborate together. One's called Aspirations in Computing, and it is for young women, 15 to 25 year olds, who get a national award for their aspirations in proven in computing with things that they've done. We are able then to keep them connected, and we have 10,000 young women now in this group that we can expose to your jobs and to potential internships. I'm happy to say there's been companies started from this group. 60% of them are not white, and they're ready to be hired. Many of them are, like I said, aged up to 25. So the diverse talent pool does exist, and it's out there. Another program that I'm proud of is the Pacesetters program, which is a group of 45 organizations that opted in to have two-year very aggressive and measurable goals towards change in their own environment. So they're working on things like improving the way they interview and select candidates to be more inclusive. They're looking at performance review. They're looking at classroom pedagogy, how their teachers and faculty teach, how and other ways of making progress in where there might be bias in systemic processes in the organizations they serve. In the past, we've had other groups of pace setters, and they've been able to double, triple, and even quadruple the number of women in their own organizations in 18 months. So this is due to a focus and also a top leadership support. Oh, thank you. Thank you. I guess it's time to change slides. It was good timing. There. So I'm going to put some data up for you. I don't expect you to be able to read it all, but this is the data on where we stand with women in technology broadly. And this is actually more focused on design and development roles in companies. So you can see that women aren't participating at the rate that they probably should be, considering they're 50% of the population. Some people think that it's because of brain differences, that potentially there's something inherently different about women and men's brains. The research actually shows that there are more differences between men's brains as a group, different groups of men, and different groups of women alone than there are between the genders, men and women. So it's not really true. Our brains are all different. And so that one's definitely not causing the issues. It's really just a need for us to get to this space. So it's not about gender alone that's going to solve this problem. It's about us solving this puzzle. Understanding all the other speakers today mentioned something around culture or different geographies or getting creative ideas from new perspectives. I think somebody told me today about Boeing having a creative idea from a high schooler. So you never know where the opportunities are going to come from when you open up and listen and think about other groups of people. What's at stake is our ability to increase innovation. So there's a lot at stake. This is just one idea of why we need to do this. Diversity has been proven in research to increase creativity. So there's a gentleman, a researcher named Scott Page. I don't know if any of you have heard of him. He likes to talk about this as in a visual way, as you could have people who think the same or in a similar way that maybe come from similar backgrounds, and they can be successful. There are companies that have been very successful with an homogenous group. It's like a cog in a wheel when there's only one cog, and it takes a full 360 degrees for it to hit the ground before it gets any traction. And he says, if you have multiple perspectives, what you get is a lot of cogs in the wheel, so that every single time you move 10 degrees, you're gonna hit the ground and get some traction. It will be slower to start, for sure, but once it's moving, it's pretty unstoppable. So this is how he talks about something called collective intelligence. I want to share with you that I'm also biased. We all are. Everyone carries some kind of bias, and it's usually unconscious that we don't really realize we have it. So in all my years at Bell Laboratories as an engineer, I worked on systems architecture and systems design. I'm biased against women in science and technology. So I took a Harvard implicit test and I learned that I do have those biases, and I attribute that to my socialization growing up. It doesn't mean, it doesn't define me, it doesn't mean that's what I believe. I'm certainly not operating on those biases, but it's partially because they're conscious now. Once I knew that I had those biases, I'm able to operate in a different way to appropriately respond, and with training, I can interrupt bias now in different environments and feel confident and comfortable to do that. So that's what we want to offer to all of our members and to all of you through our research. And just to make sure that you realize that this is a competency. It's something that can be learned and practiced. So this is one thing that we do for individuals. We talk about, and you can't see this slide, but it came from work with one of the most innovative companies in the world, Apple Computer. We're doing some deep dive with them on their own internal culture, and we're developing this on the fly as we go with them through the process of really digging in. But what are some of the scenarios that you might come across that you need to address that either today you're not saying anything because you're not sure how to respond, or you're definitely not saying anything because you don't want to lose your political capital, or there's other reasons why you don't want to offend someone, you're just not sure. So these are scenarios, and on the left side of the slide are the things that we would teach you about, what it means to have a fixed mindset versus a growth mindset. And these are things that are good for men and women. This is definitely, like I said, not a gender issue, really. It's more about just inclusiveness in across the population of the people who you work with. It's about getting to that spot of understanding what did I hear? It's called the dark ages. Everyone has to take the dark arts. Sorry, not ages, dark arts. Harry Potter's dark arts. This is your dark arts. And we're happy to share that with you in terms of what we know works as an individual so that you can learn and practice and understand the language, but feel comfortable doing it. And as an organization, we have systemic change models that have been growing, and we've been learning with our community over the years. It's been 12 years now with NCWIT to figure out which spaces and focus areas you need to work on as a company or a university or even a K-12 school, and where you can put your focus as an individual to look for things that might creep into an interview process. Well, women aren't applying for the job. Well, they just aren't interested. So ask yourself, is it because they're not interested, or maybe there's another reason? And maybe there are other underrepresented groups who aren't applying for the job. So we see things as simple as the way that the language in your job ads can be turning off people who aren't the traditional culture fit. We like to say disrupt the status quo. Let us help you change that language, make it more inclusive, and we'll test your existing ad with your new job ad, and we'll see if we can't pull a more diverse candidate pool. So we do those kinds of things. We'll be doing that with Virgin soon. I welcome that with any of you to try it out, to test small things, to be successful with something small in your company, and then talk about it. Because if in reality, you need to do all of these things in order to create a sustainable, inclusive culture. And many of you are with small and growing companies where you can start from the beginning and you don't have the issues that the bigger companies have. But most of you, I think, are with large companies that already have these issues of imbalance and not enough diversity. And so we're going to have to take small parts, just like good computer scientists, right? We have to break the problems down into smaller bits. So that's what we do. And so now I want to hand it over, because I think we have three panelists here that want to tell you about other types of results. But I am available, and I'm very passionate about the space industry, trying to move that forward, and I welcome you to reach out to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Jill. Doug?
You're having slides, right?
Yeah, just leave it there. Just leave it there, and then if you need it.
Okay.
It's up to you.
Sure. So I'm really excited about the opportunity to talk about this topic, kind of moving it forward from where we were last year. I think the place where we start in looking at this problem, and I know it's true with many of my colleagues, it really comes from a business imperative that builds around the fact that most of us are in a significant growth period over the next several years, and particularly looking at all the things we heard about this morning in commercial and space flight in the defense divisions, it's the same way. And with that growth is overlaid a demographic that shows a lot of people retiring and our workforce changing out. So we literally have thousands of hires that we have to make over the next 5 years across our company. So we embarked several years ago on a sort of rigorous path to really build into our processes the ability to bring more diversity in the company. But that's pretty much the blocking and tackling, the human resource process, all that. But getting the leadership characteristics associated with encouraging that kind of diversity and inclusion is really what I wanted to spend time talking about. And it, again, it's because we also find ourselves in a competitive situation in terms of talent. In aerospace and defense, I think more and more we're starting to look at ourselves as being in the technology arena, really, not just aerospace and defense. And back in the day, it used to be there was A&D, and then there were sort of these other technology things. Now, everybody's fighting for the same people. So Google, Amazon, you know, take your pick, and Boeing, Northrop, and so on, so it goes. And we're all competing for the same graduates and the same talent in the industry. So again, competitive edge, and also reflecting the demographics of our country that are shifting. So we focus on those steps around the diversity component for bringing in talent. It's really starting at the grade school and high school level by funding a lot of lower level high school programs, college programs, where we're really getting connected with young talent early and bringing them up through the process, encouraging them into the STEM fields. And then as they move into college, recruiting in a way that's really more focused on a handful of universities around the country rather than a mile wide and not an inch deep. But those universities that also are putting a premium on diverse college and student bodies. So kind of building on that, and then once folks are brought into the company, then we have been focused on accelerating talent that gives us the ability to bring some innovation and diversity into the thought process. So different educational backgrounds, different geographical backgrounds, different experiential backgrounds actually have a premium over just the former typical engineering characteristics that one would look for in a technology-based field like ours. So a number of things that could be done there, and we talked quite a bit about some of those last time. I think as this topic has morphed over the last two conferences, really looking at the bias aspect and what I would say the inclusion piece of leadership and how you manage in a workforce that's become very diverse. And that's where we're spending a lot of time on the leadership aspect, because it really comes down to creating an engaged workforce. An engaged workforce won't be present if people aren't allowed to be present at work as their authentic selves. So allowing for that authenticity inside the realm of work, allowing the culture to be forgiving to various diverse characteristics people may have in terms of how they work and operate is a leadership challenge for a community that's usually been sort of cookie cutter for many years. So that transition is well on its way, but not without its challenges. I can say from my own personal experience, you know, just people bringing, as we brought our company together over the years, lots of mergers and acquisitions, and you get different cultures coming from different parts of the company. And, you know, when someone comes from a different site from a different former company, it's right away there's this view that one has that, oh, they're gonna kind of come at the problem this way because that's kind of how they do things over in that part of the company. Well, that's an inclusory challenge that leadership faces. So we have to move people around a lot, get people, challenge people, and put them in uncomfortable places, working in an area that's not something they're typically used to, or a cultural pocket of the company that they're not typically used to get them to maybe see a broader perspective. It's as simple as, you know, meetings where we have people that, you know, you have a big conference room table and three or four people always like to sit against the wall and there's plenty of room at the table. Get them to come up to the table because that's where the conversation's going to occur. And in the leadership context, drawing people out that aren't willing to talk or feel like they're a little uncomfortable, going around the entire table, getting people to engage. I mean, these are These are tactics that have been around for a long time, but I think the workforce of today and of the future is putting a higher premium on the ability to do that and to create a culture that accommodates it and allows for it. So again, the diversity piece through bringing a more diverse workforce in, and then in terms of inclusion, changing the leadership characteristics and the way leaders occur and show up, and then also putting a premium and a reward on developing those kind of characteristics in our leaders so that they advance and people have that to aspire to. So that's it.
Right.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you.
So I think we're at the other end of the spectrum in terms of organization size, but yes, we were prompted to be more proactive by the equivalent panel discussion at ISPCS last year. And I think in previous years, we'd done various things, but not under a conscious program and not so extensively. So it was a wake-up call to us a year ago, or at least a snooze alarm to something maybe that we should have already recognized. Actually, in the early years of our development, Virgin Galactic was very diverse. When we incubated the project in London, from a gender perspective, it was pretty much running at 50-50 most of the time. And you know, the significant change came when we set up the US part of the operation, which is now 98% of it. When we started setting up the engineering teams and the technician teams in Mojave and later in Long Beach, the two sites that we develop our vehicles and manufacture and test, that's when these things started happening. So, we've grown now to an organization that's about 700 employees. So still small in comparison with many organizations in the industry and represented here, but large enough to be more intentional about our approach on diversity in our workforce and building a more inclusive culture, whether you're looking at it from the perspective of gender or racial and ethnic makeup or sexual orientation or religion or personal background or other considerations. So more aware of what was happening in the industry, myself and the other members of the leadership team looked at our own stats and looked at the demographics, and although we are more diverse than we were a couple of years ago, we certainly saw the need to take some action for our own people's equity and also to benefit our business performance. So we initiated various things. I'm just going to talk about a few of them today. Many are still work in progress. What my colleague Will Pomerantz said here last year was that these are experiments. We're trying to see how they go. And so again, we can talk about progress, but we're more interested really to hear about the activities and initiatives of others, and especially those who've had programs running for many years now. So overall, our going in position for the program was not to target certain percentages to get from this to this. It was more a case of how do we need to develop as an organization to make our culture, our approach, the opportunities that arise be ones that embrace diversity and build inclusion. And one thing that got started straight away was having that diversity conversation in the senior staff meetings and also presenting to our board on the status of the situation. Because what gets measured gets done, and acknowledging the situation was important. We put together a diversity working group with working level representatives from all locations, all areas of our business. So the space tourism side, the satellite launch business, and I'm championing that group. We took the decision to catch up quicker by working with NCWIT, as Jill mentioned. So we became Entrepreneurial Alliance members of NCWIT this year, and they're helping us develop our approach. And in fact, we're proud to be the first space organization to establish a link with them. We started looking for implicit or unconscious bias in our organization, and starting with an awareness sessions, really, formatted in a lunch and learn presentation format to members of the organization. We're participating in this panel again, as a statement of intent and also as an acknowledgement that we've got much to learn and some distance to travel. We participated in the McKinsey Lean In Org Women in the Workplace survey earlier this year, the one from which results were published last month. We supported the AIAA benchmarking survey. We've worked with ISPCS also to co-develop and co-sponsor a summit on Friday, a summit about the power of inclusion. And we're going to have that at our facility at Spaceport America, just north of here. That's where we're going to operate our human spaceflight program, and it's also potentially the venue for further events if that summit proves worthwhile. And I'm pleased to say that our CEO, George Whitesides, our lead on human spaceflight, Mike Moses, who will be speaking here tomorrow, and our business development lead on satellite launch, Barry Matsumori, will all be attending the summit and demonstrating the top-level support, you know, along with folk from other organizations and education groups. Second area, maybe looking at recruitment. We've continued and grown out our range of activities with education groups to encourage a more diverse groups to enter the pool of potential employees of the future across all our centers, Mojave, Long Beach, here in Las Cruces. And to take some local examples, working with the local school system here, Las Cruces Public Schools, class visits, video chats with elementary and middle school students. Working with the Challenger Center here in Las Cruces, which has attendance on two immersive learning missions baked into the sixth grade curriculum, and we delivered part of their summer school program in June. Building links with New Mexico State University here in Las Cruces, and particularly with their Women in STEM group. Reaching out to the Girl Scouts of the USA, where we'll be supporting them before and at their triennial national convention in October next year. Working with Big Brother, Big Sister here in Las Cruces in Albuquerque, where we're supporting the Discovery Festival in November. Participating as a founder member in the Brooke Owens Fellowship Program with staff mentoring students in that program. And continuing to offer scholarships through Galactic Unite, the partnership between ourselves and our community of future astronaut customers, with a good number of those scholarships going in the direction specifically targeted to underserved communities. And then whether we're talking to graduates or people who've been in employment for some time, reviewing how we attract people who are already in the pool of employees, the job ads, the recruitment notices, the wording we use, what we say about the necessary experience and qualifications and so on, the selection process, is it equitable, has bias been removed, the induction process once they join is being worked on, and more. Looking at reward and recognition and, that side of things, Doug's already commented a bit about that, on that. Our diversity group spent quite a bit of time digging into the demographic states. There were quite a few engineers and they wanted data. So they wanted to identify actionable trends, and they spent quite a bit of time doing that and coming with some initial suggestions which we're implementing. And we also, didn't want them to sit there too long thinking about things. We wanted to encourage them and empower them to secure some quick wins in several areas. So reviewing work environments for unconscious bias, for example, was something that they did. And we, again, nominated female employees for Women in Aerospace Awards this year. We didn't get any winners this year, but we have in previous years. But it gives visibility in the team, and it gives visibility outside the organization. And we've increased the number of women who represent the company at external events like these. And so in general, we've created more opportunities for cross-collaboration and engagement in the company through events, activities, and outreach that support the diversity and inclusion efforts that we're making in the company and the value that we place on them. Looking at advancement and retention, we're trying to make sure that everybody's potential is unlocked. Of course, we are, like everybody else, to the maximum extent. And partly that's about making sure the progress that they can make is open to all, it's equitable in reward, and the sorts of things I was talking about in the previous section. But it's also about understanding individuals' particular situations and considering those in the way that we develop and act as an organization. And also trying to make our culture as encouraging as possible. And one example of that is, which shouldn't be necessary, I suppose, but I think people tell us that it is building a network of male allies through the organization. We recognize that it's about how diverse teams work once you have them also. And there's an interesting book called Team Genius, which came out not long ago, which amongst other things comments that the most successful teams exhibit diversity in their ranks, but also recognizes and expands on the issue that diverse teams often face certain challenges. So that kind of thing is also part of our considerations as we move forward. So finally, alongside all of the above, we just have made more effort to educate ourselves, and we found that just by having our leadership support the initiative and the diversity team focus, and plus starting work with NCWIT, that we're more tuned in to what others are doing and the opportunities, whether that's in research or in practice. And on that note, I'll mention another good book that we've encountered recently and would recommend, which is called What Works by Iris Bonnet, who's a behavioral economist and a professor at Harvard University. And it was published in April, and it looks at achieving equality by design, and it's got some interesting comments in, for example, when diversity is essential to different task types. And if you're attending our summit on Friday, you will get a free copy. So that's a report from a journey in progress, really. Thanks for listening, and enjoy the rest of the event.
Melissa?
Great. Wonderful. Good afternoon. And I believe my first chart when you're ready, please. This afternoon, I want to share a success story with you. It is called BLAST. BLAST stands for Building Leadership and Sustaining Talent. It is a mid-career leadership development program that ULA created. It was originally founded in 2011. We've graduated two classes over the last 5 years, and it's a highly selective program targeted to select employees to develop them over a 2.5-year process. For me, I had the privilege of being the program lead. I also am a coach and mentor to each of the participants to help them navigate the program, navigate unfamiliar situations, and to grow themselves, not only as leaders, but as employees and as people during their time in the program. The program's incredibly challenging. We challenge people to have new experiences, place them in unfamiliar situations, unfamiliar problems, and challenge them to step up and problem solve as part of a team working with diversity of thought and inclusion. So, one of the primary hallmarks of the program and one of the reasons that I believe it was a success is a diversity of experience. The participants go through 6-month projects. They are intentionally in a part of the company that they are not familiar with. And in 6 months, which isn't a very long period of time, the participants are expected to engage, get the project going. Often the projects aren't completed, but the project needs to be well developed enough that the team can move forward with it and complete the execution. So for example, what do I mean when I say unfamiliar? We move engineers into HR. We move engineers into finance. You don't go from being a propulsion engineer to an avionics engineer. We will move people completely out of engineering. Our company doesn't function with only engineers. We need all of our departments working together, from engineering to legal to finance, to make our rockets successful. Also, on the flip side, for our finance participants, they don't get to stay in finance. We move them into production. We put them on our manufacturing floor. We move them into our launch operations, which is one of our most critical points of our business. So each of these 6-month assignments, which we call stretch assignments, which is probably an understatement, it nurtures the curiosity of the participants. It increases their problem solving, and it creates new perspective. It gives the participants an opportunity to walk in someone else's shoes across our company. And often, walking in someone else's shoes is one of the best ways to help understand how we as a company work, to build a network of peers and mentors and advisors, and to be more productive and more effective in our jobs because we have a solid network that extends across our entire company. One of the interesting outcomes, and one of the statistics I'll share with you, is that over 80% of our graduates are now in leadership. All of our graduates are in high demand. There's actually managers who are coming to the program to pull people out of the program saying, I know that BLAST is a success, and I want the people coming out of this program to work for me. Interestingly enough, one of the side benefits has been the level of trust created with our graduates. Because the graduates have spent 2.5 years together in very challenging situations, when the graduates move into other areas in the company, they have trust with their cohorts, with the people who went through the similar experiences. So we now have leaders who are creating our leadership pipeline that know they can reach out to each other to help problem solve. We've seen increased effectivity with these leaders working across the company to solve problems that they're seeing with their departments and with their teams, and helping move the company forward with new and creative and innovative solutions. So the best way that I can summarize one of the objectives of our programs and one of the results is that our participants and graduates are comfortable being uncomfortable. They embrace challenge, they embrace problems, they're excited to go and figure out how to solve not only the problems that we have today, but what are the problems that we will face as a commercial industry with our space flight and tourism, and how do we move into this lunar economy? The program has resulted in a permanent change of perspective. This has led to a diversity of thought with our graduates, and it's driven directly by the diversity of experiences and challenges that the participants have encountered and overcome during the program. Certainly, the executive support has made this program possible. As both Jonathan and Doug and Jill have all mentioned, the program wouldn't have been possible without support from our top management at United Launch Alliance. Some of our next steps are to broaden our reach to more employees. How do we reach more employees? How do we continue to drive a diversity of experience, perhaps in a shorter time frame than 2.5 years? Can we do it in 12 months, for example? So these are some of the questions that we're asking ourselves as we move forward and continue to develop our leadership pipeline. ULA will not stop increasing our collective intelligence through new perspectives, through driving experiences, and through bringing a diversity of thought into our leadership. Thank you. I'll turn it back over to Sandy.
Thank you, everyone, for those insights into what's going on at your various companies and, of course, at NCWIT. We'll have some audience questions in a moment, but there are a couple things I wanted to sort of talk about amongst ourselves a little bit first. You know, the first is a question of metrics. You talked about a lot of the metrics that you're tracing, and then, Doug, you mentioned a lot of different things that your company's doing to reach out to students and things like that. And I'm curious, and let me just finish this and come back, that, you know, how you're using those metrics to justify different investments. And Jonathan, you're talking about progress. You've done this for about a year, and you're tracking progress. How are you measuring your progress and being able to report that? And then Melissa, you talked about a few of your metrics, but I'm curious if you discussed if this affects retention or if you need to go to early career people and how you would measure that. So really, I think we all struggle with, when we try any kind of new project or program, how do you establish the right metrics? How do you communicate those metrics and keep the senior, you know, the senior management interested in engaging and investing in these kind of programs? So why don't we just go down the line and you can tackle that however you want to. So Jill and then Doug.
I'll just have a quick comment because it's really all of you that are actually doing the implementation. Mm-hmm. We're learning alongside and then being able to share those learnings, that's all. But one of the things that I thought was relevant here was the crawl, walk, run analogy. Is that a lot of companies think they need to assign a chief diversity officer and then hot potato everything that's nasty to that person and anything that's uncomfortable or social science or behavior issues. And we've seen that obviously doesn't work. So what we say is pick something small like a job ad and try to improve it with one of your most strategic technical roles because we work in the space of technology innovation. But you could essentially do this with anything. And the goal doesn't have to be to get a diverse person hired because that doesn't feel good to all the white men that are there contributing for years and have a great success. What you want to do is say, let's get a more diverse candidate pool. Let's see if we can at least do that because then we can choose the best person for the job and know that we did our part with including them in the process.
Okay, yeah. I think from metrics viewpoint, certainly at middle management and above, any open position requires what we call a diverse slate of candidates. So, you know, if there's a position that needs to be filled, there has to be at least three candidates, and there have to be from those dimensions. So, it does sometimes take time to create those candidate pools, and it takes more. It's longer to fill that position, but you've got to do it. And so in the long run, it's a better approach. And so we hold ourselves to that measurement. As far as STEM and the investments there, we through the Northrop Grumman Foundation, we spend quite a bit every year around the country at the high school and grade school level in programs. And in each of those programs over time, many of them are a number of years old, we track the students that are embellished by that funding, and then watch where they how they progress on through the system. In particular, we'll have a partnership with a Da Vinci school, say in the South Bay, and then since we have a partnership with Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, then some of those students will go to Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, and then we'll track them through that way. So we measure it at the investment level and the grade school and high school level, and then the college metrics are pretty rigorous and are all about the intern system. We'll do between 500 and 800 interns a year across our portion of the company, which puts a big strain on programs and projects that have to perform when they've got lots of interns on the program. But it pays off in the long run because the kids get really great experiences and they're doing real work, and they're more likely to move quickly right into the workforce. So we measure that pretty rigorously in terms of the number, obviously the numbers that are recruited and brought in, but then the exit interviews, what the exit interview says about how their experience was, what worked, what didn't work, and then whether or not they come back, and if they're graduating, then did they get hired? So tracking them through their entire life cycle, for lack of a better term, so that we can understand our effectiveness around that.
I'm still a little bit amused that our whole company is less than the size of their intern group.
Like it was
so
last
far,
year.
Yeah.
So far. Yeah, I mean, I think there's maybe four things that I could talk to about that. You know, it is relatively early days, but awareness, I think, is part of it. So just having the information available to people, by, you know, such measures as gender, racial and ethnic numbers, and by age group as well, and regularly updating that. We do that update quarterly. I think part of it is communication about what we're doing and why we're doing it, and, you know, talking about that it's what's going to help us grow as an organization. It's not about replacing anybody. You know, we're not trying to hit targets by taking out those 10 people and bringing in 10 different people. So that is very much part of the conversation that goes on in the organization. Once the diversity team had got the data, you know, it gave us the opportunity to start being more equitable, because they did put their fingers on some situations where rewards weren't equal, and position, you know, for positions and for gender. And so it gave us the opportunity to correct those situations. And some of it, quite frankly, is, you know, is just qualitative. You know, internally, some of the comments that, you know, come from people about the culture and you know, what's going on in the organization. Somebody was saying to me this morning, and I was really humbled, you know, I have never felt more comfortable in an organization than I feel in this one. So that's great to hear, you know, from somebody who's in, you know, some of those minority groups. Some of it is external, qualitative, really, the response to some of the outreach activity we do, for example, and just the fact that we get invited back sometimes is a measure, you know, that something's been achieved. That's it.
Okay. And Melissa?
Certainly. One of the items that you had mentioned, Sandy, was early career professionals. We do have a complementary program that is called ULA Ambassadors, and that's targeted specifically at early career professionals. It has a slightly different profile, but similar objectives. So it's the programs are not mutually exclusive. It's definitely something that you could participate in both throughout your career. Right now, our retention is 100% for our BLAST program graduates. We are very proud of that. We believe that it does lead to higher engagement within the company by having a more broad understanding of both the company itself and our strategy going forward. It brings a different perspective and I believe provides more opportunities for career growth. One of the other touch points that we use is direct testimonials from managers who now have program graduates working for them. I go and speak with the managers personally to find out if the program has made a difference, what do the managers see from the employees who are working for them, and what changes, most importantly, what changes and improvements can we make to the program? What are the managers perhaps not seeing that they would like to see going forward?
Excellent. So one more question, then we'll go to one from the audience. A lot of, you know, we talk about diversity, and then we talk about inclusion, which is what you're doing with the diversity when you get it. And a big key, I think, in that is just learning how to listen and creating an environment where people feel like they're heard, whether or not that opinion is actually acted on or not. So I was just curious if you would all like to address how you're dealing with the training or the skill set or the discussions around listening versus not listening, and how that could be affecting whether you have an inclusive or not inclusive environment.
Yeah, that one's huge, and I think you know, in terms of inclusion and allowing people to be their authentic selves in the workplace, and really understanding how people feel about their situation at work and the safety of expressing themselves, we as well as many companies, as you all know, do what are called engagement surveys. And in those engagement surveys, which generally get about 85% to 90% response, we have a verbatim section. And as leadership and management, everyone is accountable right down to each individual unit level relative to their engagement scores and how they're handling their team and their work area relative to those verbatim feedback. And it's some pretty painful stuff over time that you see, but over time as well, you see a shift and an improvement when you start looking at it. We've been on about a 5-year journey with that data. And that's helped a lot, because it's helped us see managers that have some flat spots, perhaps, around inclusion. One thing we've done that puts a premium on this is that our evaluation process used to be completely goal-based, and now it's 50% goal-based, so what you do, and the other 50% you're scored on how you do it. So it's one thing to create great results but leave a lot of dead bodies. It's not sustainable I was saying that figuratively, especially around this crowd. But the point is that it's not sustainable if you're creating results and not creating an engaged workforce, and you're not using leadership characteristics that are consistent with the values of the culture. So the engagement surveys give us a lot of in-depth feedback annually that then there's an expectation on each individual manager right up and down the chain to have plans in place to address some aspect of the feedback they've received. And so over time, we're really starting to see an improvement that has shown in the verbatims that people are much more comfortable in expressing dissenting views and with the cultural evolution that we've been on. So that's our tool.
So I have a question from the audience. How is diversity of age managed? It's kind of the elephant in the room, diversity, right? I don't know if anybody wants to take it. That's open to the floor.
Well, one of the big themes that I didn't mention, but others have touched on through the day, is that inclusion also leads to innovation. And so, you know, if you have 8 people the same mindset around a table, same background, 8 old white guys like myself, we're going to come out with a certain result. If we're looking for innovation and new thought, fresh ideas, we've got to bring in different backgrounds and younger backgrounds. And the energy level of the younger part of the workforce is amazing. I think initially we had that sort of stigma, and there was sort of, wow, you know, I'm being left out. But that's changed in the last year or two as we become much more inclusive around bringing in hundreds of interns every year and bringing in a lot of new college hires has really helped a lot. And people are starting to see the energy that it generates, the innovation that comes from having a mixture. There still has to be experience there. There still has to be some guidance around, you know, certain paths that have been tried and that need to be, rather than relearning the same lesson, let's not go that path, but maybe let's try something close to it. So I think it's healthy, but it does take time for the culture to adjust, is what we've seen.
Yeah. Jonathan, you know, Virgin, you outlined a very mindful approach to diversity. For a small company, that's really extraordinary, given that you don't have a lot of extra bandwidth to absorb work. You know, you have a core thing you're trying to accomplish. Do you feel that the push for diversity has distracted you from the core? competencies of what you're trying to accomplish. And the reason I'm asking is because other small companies may be put off from trying what you're doing because they would perceive that to be a barrier, you know, as a distraction, if you will, from just trying to get the things moving. I don't know if you care to address that dynamic.
Yeah. We don't see it as a distraction at the moment, and you know we see it as part of the process of building our culture and engaging with our team, and you know the very fact that they can see those efforts being made by people at all levels, not just the senior team sponsoring it and being part of it, but also because we've included people at all levels in the diversity team working on it. You know, we've got three different organisations that are growing in different ways from different. You know, different sources. You know, we've got the operations team that are going to, you know, fly people. We've got the spaceship company that makes vehicles, and we've got the launcher business that is developing satellite launch. They're all grown in a different way, and they all take, you know, they have different pools. But one thing that seems to be in common that attracts people, you know, in at an early age, commensurate with, you know, being able to do the job, is because they get a range of experience that they might not get in other organizations. So we see that it's definitely worth doing.
So your message to other small companies is take this on, it's definitely worth it, and it can, it's a strength and not a distraction.
We believe so, yeah. But, you know, we're open to the experience that we're going to gain on that, you know, in the coming years.
Okay. One last question I'll ask Melissa. If you were making a non-engineering hire in the space business, say sales or marketing, where would you market the position? That's a question from the audience.
Certainly. It's interesting because we are challenged to hire non-engineers. All of the other functions that actually make a business run, often those people don't apply. I think that one of my first calls would probably be to Jill at NCWIT to get some advice on where are some of the best places to market those jobs. But we need to reach out beyond the engineering schools, beyond some of the traditional markets for aerospace, which is a very tight-knit community, fortunately, but it sometimes doesn't attract the people with different skills who say, well, I don't know how I fit into aerospace. So I think I would not only ask for some help and advice, but also make sure that our job descriptions were inclusive and that we weren't excluding people unintentionally.
Yeah, I think we'll end with that and with a comment that Jill started us off at the very beginning about some of the things that they're doing at NCWIT to work with Virgin On and others, the Pacesetters program, where you're looking at the interviewing process, the selection process, the how you put the job descriptions out there to remove unconscious bias and diversity. I would encourage anybody who's interested in this topic to follow up with Jill and NCWIT offline, because I think there's a lot of valuable lessons there that we can learn, because, you know, just thinking about it right now, I have no idea what even we're doing at AIAA that might be involved in these kinds of same questions. So thank you guys very much for all of your discussion. I think it was very helpful, and let's give our panel a round of applause as we close.